Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today we are continuing with the Bhagavad Gita series after a month almost. And we had discussed on the second chapter, 12th verse, we discussed half of it, and now we will discuss the remaining half. Hopefully, we will complete the entire verse today itself. All right, so let us recite the verse once again. And before that, we could offer prayers to our preceptors who have enlightened us with this knowledge. Om Agyan Timirandhasya Gyanan Jana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namah. This prayer is very important. All right. The 12th shloka is as follows. Natvevaham jato nasam natvam neme janadhipa nachaivana bhavishyama sarve vayamada param. And as usual, if you are new to the channel, please subscribe to it. And if you have not watched the previous videos, then please watch it. It is there in this Bhagavad Gita playlist, or else you may be clueless about what I am speaking. All right, so in the last video, we saw that the explanation to the first part, never was there a time when I did not exist, nor you, nor all these kings, nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. So whenever we are reading the Bhagavad Gita, it's very important that we do not just read through it. It's not a matter of just finishing, all right? There is no deadline. So let us read the translation once again. Never was there a time when I did not exist. Who is this I? I is referring to Krishna. He is speaking about himself. Nor you. Who is you? You is Arjuna himself. Nor all these kings. Basically, Krishna is referring to Drona, Bhishma and Duryodhana and Yudhishthira and all the kings. Nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. That means Krishna is hinting at the eternity of the soul. That the soul is eternal. We existed, we are existing, and we will always exist. And then in the purport, there was this famous shloka. Nityo nityanam chetanas chetananam eko bahunam yo vidadati kama. Alright, so we discussed in the first part of the purport that how everybody is an individual, and when we make spiritual progress, it is not that we lose our individuality and we become nothing from something. We were always somebody. We were never something. Always remember that. People say, no, I am something. No, you are not something. You are somebody. You are a body. Body means not this body. You are a soul. You are a person. All right. So once there was a class which one guru was giving, and then the guru said, you are not this body, you are spirit soul. And then one person got confused and he went and asked the guru that, okay, you are saying I am not my body, then whose body am I? Well, the guru said, no, you are nobody's body. You are not a body, in fact, but you are still somebody. So you are a spirit soul. You, me, everybody else. Anybody who is living, the symptom of the soul is Satchit Ananda, full of eternity, full of knowledge and full of bliss. Ananda, Sat Chit Ananda. Ananda refers to bliss. And the Vedanta Sutra says, you know, Ananda Mayo Bhyasa, the soul is accustomed to unlimited pleasure, eternal pleasure. So that level of pleasure cannot be obtained in the materialistic objects of this world. The materialistic objects of this world can satisfy us to some extent, not beyond that. So that's the problem. We think that anything and everything of this material world will be able to give us unlimited amount of pleasure. Well, that's not true, because the substance itself is limited. The famous example is given that of gulab jamun, that maybe there are 100 gulab jamuns which somebody comes and gifts you, but can you eat all the 100? Yeah, maybe you can eat 50, maybe 30, maybe 40. But what after that? After that, you have to surrender. So even if there are unlimited gulab jamuns in this world, but our ability to eat them is limited. So therefore, let us see what Krishna is speaking here, right? Krishna affirms his individuality in the past and confirms his individuality in the future also. He has confirmed his individuality in many ways. An impersonal Brahman has been declared to be subordinate to him. Krishna has maintained spiritual individuality all along. If he is accepted as an ordinary conditioned soul in individual consciousness, then his Bhagavad Gita has no value as an authoritative scripture. So basically this means that if we accept Krishna as just another person who is inside a body like us, then his words have no value, or not to the extent of the Bhagavad Gita, because then he would be just like one amongst us. But that's not true. His body is fully Sachit Ananda. Now we are also Sachit Ananda. But the problem is we are currently engrossed in this material body which you see. So therefore, our ability to understand and comprehend things of this world and spirituality is very limited. And it's full of faults and defects, which is mentioned here in the purport as we study now. And if Krishna would be like us, then we could have never accepted him as an authority on the scriptures. Now, a common man with all the four defects of human frailty is unable to teach that which is worth hearing. So just look around. There are many people who keep giving a lot of lectures on politics, or you know, movies, or so many things people keep speaking. But you will see that their content has no substance. At the end, it doesn't benefit you, even though they are talking of so many things. But that's what is mentioned. It is not worth hearing. So whose message is worth hearing? It is only Krishna's message, only the divine message, only God's message, which is worth hearing. The Gita, Bible, Quran, whichever religious tradition you belong to. The Gita is above such literature. No mundane book compares with the Bhagavad Gita. When one accepts Krishna as an ordinary man, the Gita loses all importance. The Mayavadi argues that the plurality mentioned in this verse is conventional and it refers to the body. But previous to this verse, such a bodily conception is already condemned. After condemning the bodily conception of the living entities, how was it possible for Krishna to place a conventional proposition of the body again? Therefore, individuality is mentioned on spiritual grounds and is thus confirmed by great acharyas like Sri Ramanuja and others. It is clearly mentioned in many places in the Gita that this spiritual individuality is understood by those who are devotees of the Lord. Those who are envious of Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead have no bona fide access to the great literature. Alright, so basically what this means is that currently we are having a individuality, but our current state of individuality is very much engrossed by this bodily conception of this body. Alright, so I am there, I have my mother, father, sister, daughter, uncle, aunt, whoever. And everything is surrounded around me. Everything's like me, me, me. Okay, me, my food, my mobile, my dress, my degree, my college, my company, my YouTube channel. But that does not mean that we do not have an identity. So our original identity is spiritual. So even when we were spiritual, or when we are spiritual, we always have an identity. But currently that is being manifested through matter. That is why this everything is centered around materialism basically for us. But this does not mean that when we become spiritual or very elevated spiritually, we just don't have any identity. It's not like that. We will still have our identity, but that will be in relation to spirit. All right. So the Mayavadi argues that the plurality mentioned in this verse is conventional and it refers to the body. But previous to this verse, such bodily conception is already condemned. So this means that the bodily conception that I have this, that is mine, he is mine, she is mine, that is mine, that is not very conducive, because matter can never possess something. Okay, and the spirit soul actually can never become matter, because the spirit soul is spirit, Atma is Atma. You cannot become anybody, you know, like the body in a gross sense. We will always remain at the core spiritual, in the inner essence. We will always remain spiritual. But the question is, how do you realize that spirituality? That is when you progress spiritually, when you awaken your consciousness, when you progress in the spiritual journey, when you realize more and more that you do not need things of this world, you need more of spiritual content to live and to survive. Therefore, Krishna is indicating to Arjuna that, my dear Arjuna, this bodily conception of life on the basis of which you are claiming that I will not fight with Duryodhana or Bhishma or Drona is condemned, because they are not the bodies. You are not your body. You are a spirit soul and they are also spirit soul. So they will never die. You will also never die. And if you talk of the body is already dead. So that's why I said in one of the previous videos, the dead body is going to die one day. Wow. Confusing, right? The example is given of that home or a house or a building which is non-living actually. But when two people or one person comes and stays there, then what happens? They will clean it, you know, they will put furnitures and they will put table, chair. So it appears as if the house is also living, but actually the house is dead. So the moment the people leave the house, it's gone. You can't stay there. You'll go, there will be cobwebs and, you know, there will be all sorts of dangerous things going on in the house. All right. So our body is also like that. The body is dead, but till the time we are living, it appears as if it is alive. But the moment we are gone, the body is gone. Okay. Therefore, individuality is mentioned on spiritual grounds and is thus confirmed by great acharyas like Sri Ramanuja and others. So Ramanujacharya is one of the greatest acharyas in the Sri Vaishnav tradition, in the Sri Sampradaya, one of the four authorized sampradayas, for one of the four authorized disciplic successions, paramparas, sampradaya for spiritual knowledge. And he is also one of them who has confirmed this idea about this individuality. Okay. It is clearly mentioned. Now, we could discuss more on Ramanujacharya. That we will do some other time. Because there are different philosophies. Like, for example, Madhvacharya is also one of the acharyas from the Madhva tradition. Brahma Madhva Sampradaya. Then, Sri Vaishnavas are also having their own philosophy. But these are all bona fide philosophies. Okay, Dvaita is one of the philosophies. Okay, and then there is Achintya Bheda Ved, which is also the same but yet a bit different. So we'll discuss on these philosophies later in detail. It is clearly mentioned in many places in the Gita that this spiritual identity is understood by those who are devotees of the Lord. So that's the homework for you, to find out where this is mentioned. All right. Those who are envious of Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead have no bona fide access to the great literature. That means those who are jealous that, oh, why is Krishna having this? Why is Krishna having that? Why Krishna did this? Why Krishna did that? Why I can't do this? He can do, I can't do. Why? Oh, if somebody is having this kind of an attitude, then they can never understand the Bhagavad Gita, because the Gita has, the Gita is like, you know, it's like a very it has a very subtle password. And it's so dangerous that generally what happens if you have some software which is very confidential and you cannot open the software, you need a password. But the Gita is so critical that even if everything is there in front of you, you read it 10 times, 1,000 times, you will never understand. Because because if we have envy in our heart for Krishna, if we are thinking that, oh, why Krishna gets everything, why I don't get anything, all right? So if that kind of attitude we are having, then we can never understand. Because Krishna says to Arjuna later on, Bhakto si me sakha cheti, that you are my devotee and sakha, my friend also. Right? So these are the two things which makes Arjuna qualified to be the recipient of the Bhagavad Gita. Otherwise, there was Duryodhana also. But Duryodhana was always envious of Krishna. He was always insulting Krishna. He was always mocking him. He used to say Krishna is a Mayavi, he's a magician, keeps doing some magical tricks around. Okay. And Sakaya, Arjuna was also a great friend of Krishna. So these are two reasons, and most importantly, he was non-envious of anybody. Alright. So these two qualities are very important. Bhakto Sime Sakha Cheti. That is mentioned later on, of course. Rasyam Hetu Duttamam, that's the end of the shloka. The non-devotees' approach to the teachings of the Gita is something like that of a bee licking on a bottle of honey. Wow. The non-devotees' approach to the teachings of the Gita is something like that of a bee licking on a bottle of honey. So imagine there's a bottle of honey, but you cannot drink the honey. You cannot lick the honey. You can only lick the bottle. Wow, that's miserable. So that's like saying, even though the honey is there, but you do not have access to that honey. That's the situation of the non-devotees who are envious of Krishna. And envy for anybody or for anything else in this world is a reflection of our envy for God. Generally, people become envious when somebody gets more money or gets a better life partner, or gets some better name, more fame than themselves. Why does that happen? Because we want the best, and when we don't get it, then we become envious. Oh, how did he get that? How did she get that? So everything is actually God's property. So when we are envious of somebody, it is indirectly hinting that, not indirectly, in fact, that's directly hinting at our envy for Krishna, because ultimately Krishna has given him or her what we are envious of. So when we are envious of somebody, it actually means we are envying Krishna, that why Krishna has given that person that, or why at all Krishna has that, why at all I don't have. How does he deserve that? It's me who should get that. How dare he get it? One cannot have a taste of honey unless one opens the bottle. So what is that opening of the bottle? It is that password of surrender and humility. Bhakto sime sakha chete, that is the password, you see. You have to be non-envious. If you are envious of anybody around you, in the office, in your home, in your society, or in your playground, you cannot understand the Bhagavad Gita. That's what happens. Many times I talk to people and they're like, oh, I have read the Gita 100 times, 10 times, 20 times, 30 times, but still, you know, I have no interest on spiritual topics. I didn't understand what's going on. I had no idea. And then I was thinking, why did I waste my time reading the Gita? All right. So just by finishing 700 shlokas, verses, that's not how you will read the Gita. You might read the Gita 1,000,000,000 times, you see, like this. There are some people who can read like this. Zoop. But still nothing goes inside. They can memorize 100 shlokas, but they will not understand what Krishna wants to tell you. That they will not understand. Apart from that, everything else they will understand. Similarly, the mysticism of the Bhagavad Gita can be understood only by devotees, and no one else can taste it, as it is stated in the fourth chapter of the book. We will come to fourth chapter, hopefully, sometime. Nor can the Gita be touched by persons who envy the very existence of the Lord. So, some people who say, where is this God? I don't believe he's there. If he's there, why is this there? So many questions. Envious. Even they cannot understand. Did you meet such people? I have met so many in this category, and you meet them and they will just simply waste your time. They will ask, oh God, if God exists, why this is like this? Why that is like this? Yeah, Sakyo, oh, Sakyo, yeah. So don't waste time with them, all right? Even if they are wasting, just push off. Our time is precious. We need to utilize it for spiritual purposes and stop debating with these people who actually do not want to understand. They just simply want to quarrel. They just simply want to fight and argue and prove to you which something they themselves don't believe. So what to do when we meet such people? I just push off. Therefore, you will see many spiritual debates, many religious debates on TV, on YouTube, on anywhere in this world. And they culminate into nothing. Have you seen? They will be fighting. And then everybody goes home. And the spectators are having a nice time. Bahut masala mil raha hai, bahut maza aa raha hai. But no spiritual elevation, zero. So if somebody is not approaching the Gita with a mood of humility and surrender, then there's no use. Alright? And you may be thinking, why am I stressing this point again and again? Because I have seen so many people. He will read the Gita, but without this mood, no use. Therefore, the Mayavadi explanation of the Gita is a most misleading presentation of the whole truth. Lord Chaitanya has forbidden us to read commentations made by the Mayavadis, and warns that one who takes to such an understanding of the Mayavadi philosophy loses all power to understand the real mystery of the Gita. If individuality refers to the empirical universe, then there is no need of teaching by the Lord. The plurality of the individual soul and of the Lord is an eternal fact and is confirmed by the Vedas as above mentioned. So, Mayavadis refer to those people who say that God doesn't have a form. God's form is Maya. Maya means illusion. Alright? So, they have this conception that God's form is an illusion, which means God is one with the universe and God is the universe only. Alright? And we are one with God. We are only God, basically. Alright? So, that stupid, idiotic philosophy which says, I am God, you are God, he is God, me is God, she is God, you are God, we are God, everybody is God. That's nonsense, because Krishna is God and we are eternally his servants. And our individuality will always be maintained, either in this material realm or in the spiritual realm. But in the material realm, it is manifesting in not a very good way. It's like the reflection, as they say. Matter is, the activities in this world is like a reflection of the spiritual world. Alright, so Krishna is an individual person. He is a person. He is a person. He was and he will be. And so are we. So this idea that the universe is God and everybody is God and he is God, I am God, you are God, she is God, me is God, that's not true. Alright, so That is a very important verse. That was a very important verse. And now the next verse is one of my favorite verses. We'll just recite the verse, the 13th verse. Dehi nosmin yatha dehe komaram yovanam jara tatha dehantara praptir dhiras tatra namuihati. As the embodied soul continuously passes in this body from boyhood to youth, to old age, the soul similarly passes into another body at death. A sober person is not bewildered by such a change. Alright, this verse is one of the most crucial verses. This shows us the progression of our material life. Alright, the next verse I mean, which we will discuss next week. And there you go. If you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding any area of your life, you can go down to the description section of my videos where you will find the link to my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and read the Gita. Then you will find Him. All right. Thank you so much.